Christina is a playwright, a TV writer, and a producer. And from 2018 to 2019, she was one of the most produced playwrights. That's amazing. So I just want to throw that out there. And without further ado, I'm going to pass it on to Christina Hamm.
Thank you so much, Andrea. And it's really a pleasure for me to be able to speak with you all today in this wonderful salon and just really giving you all an opportunity to share your work. I also was an educator myself, and I still am. I just consider myself to be on a hiatus from teaching college. But I also taught playwriting and screenwriting at several universities. And one of the things I would always tell my classes is that, you know, the class is not a dictatorship, that I was also looking forward to learning as much from my students as I was interested in helping teach them. So I want to at least look at this opportunity, even in this seminar, while I'm sharing information, is really getting to learn more about all of you as artists and also getting to know your work as well, which I'm really looking forward to. I could just start out by saying that I've always been interested in writing. I feel like I came into this world knowing that I wanted to be a writer. I didn't really deviate from that. Even when I was in high school, I found ways to write. I was on the school newspaper when I got to undergrad. I was a creative writing major and a poli sci major, and also took a lot of film classes because I went to USC. Which is one of our top film schools. And that really gave me an opportunity to keep my feet both in film. TV wasn't as big as it is now. It was more about independent cinema. So I was also a script reader at Warner Brothers, in addition to doing my grad school work at UCLA. And so I'm actually 3 hours behind you guys because I'm still in Los Angeles right now. I think one of the things that was really useful to me in terms of creating a career as both a writer and as an artist was that all of my day jobs had to do with writing in some way, and they've all informed the work that I do now as a TV writer. So I started out in public relations, and I worked for the Museum of Contemporary Art, your kind of equivalent to MoMA in New York. And I worked in their communications department. And I also worked in book publishing for a number of years. And I also worked for the City of Los Angeles in the public affairs department, doing newsletters for them, doing annual reports, any kind of corporate communications, and I also did speech writing for the elected officials out here in the city. And so I would say, in terms of the work that I've done on the multiple TV shows I've been on, all of those skills I use more than my actual writing skills. The writing skills I use last. In PR, you have to be able to pitch and sell a product. And in TV rooms, you have to be able to pitch and sell your ideas to get them on the board, because TV writing is a very communal exercise. It starts out with everyone in the room brainstorming constantly, whereas other fields that we're in, whether it's playwriting, fiction writing, poetry, all of those things are very, they can be very isolating for a while until you come together in a larger group when your work is ready. And so I think really looking at those different opportunities has been a very good way to really think about how writing can be used in different ways and not just thinking that you need to be able to do one thing. I think I can at least say with TV and even features, they're constantly looking for people who've had different kinds of experiences to do storytelling. They're not just looking for people who've come out of film and TV schools to be able to work on shows right now. And definitely when it comes to looking at plays that are being produced and especially in the times that we're in now, they're really looking for people who are really looking for honesty. And I think it's kind of a call to arms for us as writers to really look at what we're talking about and really getting in touch with who we are as artists. And also, I understand that you guys are working on your own mission statements as well. And I think that that's a terrific opportunity to really figure out not just who you are as writers, but also being able to tell other people. I know that I've met with a lot of young writers who want to get into other fields besides playwriting, and they want to go into TV, but they can't really talk about their work or what excites them. And so really being able to do that, I think, is an important first step in being able to start to get into the field that you want to do right now. I think it's a great opportunity, especially for newcomers.
Do I have enough time, Andrea, or?
Yeah.
I do. Can I start reading right now?
Yeah, for sure.
Okay.
So one of the things, I know that Andrea and Erica have both talked to me about, I know you guys have also started doing some TV stuff, and my lecture is going to overlap quite a bit with that because I do both. And I think it's important to understand that they're not isolated anymore. I'm sure you guys know that TV is constantly looking for playwrights. Like, they're looking for them more so than they are looking for any other writers right now. So it's a good opportunity to, you know, start to look at ways to break in and to also find, you know, create material that is unique to you and that can also be a terrific writing sample. I know a lot of times they talk about how you need to write a pilot in order to get staffed on a TV show. I actually didn't write a pilot until I was on my third TV series. And the thing that has gotten me staffed the most is actually a play that I wrote when I lived in Minneapolis called The Hollow. And I wrote it as a response to a Sarah Rule essay that she had written. She had written this collection of a small book of essays. And one of them had talked about why don't people write murder mysteries anymore for the stage. And I was like, that's a good question. I love those. I know some people think they're cheesy, but I think they're actually kind of fun and a great way to keep people engaged. And so I went ahead to set out and write my own murder mystery that's also has supernatural ghost elements in it that takes place in New Orleans. And it's gotten me staffed on 4 TV shows now. And it's also the play that gets me the most meetings for other shows and other projects that I've done. So I have not had to have a pilot, and I have several friends who've actually not necessarily gotten staffed by writing pilots, but if you can write a compelling play that tells your story or something that's unique to you, because you think about these executives, they read hundreds and hundreds of pilots, and a lot of them aren't necessarily very good. And I'm sure those of you, if you think about TV shows that you've watched of late, I'm sure you can think immediately, like, how did this even get on the air? The writing's not very good. Like, it's not compelling. And so really, if you think of your play as a writing sample, it can be a respite to these executives who are overladen with, you know, basically very bad pilots. It doesn't mean that you won't have to write one sooner or later, because I had to as well. But it does mean that it can be another doorway into the business. And I would say also, even if you're a short story writer, I can't really speak to poetry, but I know if you write short stories or magazine articles, those are also completely viable writing samples. I have a friend who's an executive producer on Grey's Anatomy, and she got staffed because she writes a lot of really compelling bylines for Elle magazine. And one of the ones she wrote was a personal byline that talked about having chemotherapy when she had to get an abortion. And her name is Elizabeth Finch, if anyone's interested in reading that article, but she's now an executive producer on Grey's Anatomy, and she continues to do magazine bylines when she's not producing for Shonda Rhimes on that show. So there's a lot of different doorways I'm sure you guys have already talked about, but just wanting to reinforce that these are other options. I should say, a lot of the shows that I've done have been genre shows. So they've been supernatural shows for the most part. And so the one that's on now is the Adventures of Sabrina that I did. But I've done three other shows that are also genre that will be on once we can shoot again after COVID lifts. But in the meantime, I'd like to read from the Hollow. And I will say, as we look to do the exercises, this is a two-person scene. It takes place in New Orleans, and I think it's also a good example of what we'll be talking about for the rest of this evening in terms of having place as a character as well, and how it informs the people within the scene. So we open on the dead of night. Around the corner, the dreamy sound of the clangety-clang of the St. Charles line wheezes along its pendulum. Calm hangs for a brief second like a pair of drapes inside the living room of the home we will come to know as Near Hollow. The residue of this residence's grander years buttons itself like an overcoat. Inside, a cacophony of whistling rises as it chafes and crawls its way through its walls. The sound of a tired porch swing rises, then falls in the distance until Olivia, offstage, someone's in the window. Wes, offstage, seeing things, give me a hand. The sound of the front door being jimmied and finally creaking open. Under the yoke of darkness, footsteps press through the entrance hall of the house. Wes enters the double parlor wearing a Mardi Gras mask with a sleeping bag underneath his arm. He throws the sleeping bag to the middle of the room. Olivia enters behind him, limping. She wears a mask as well. She throws her sleeping bag in the middle of the room. She puts her arm on his shoulder. It becomes apparent that one of her shoes is missing. Olivia walks to a wall switch and flips it. Nothing happens. She flips it again and again. Olivia, nothing. Wes, I'll double check the breaker box in the morning. Olivia, can't believe you didn't bring the flashlight. She opens the drapes as the scene continues to be lit by the full moon. It reveals a grandfather clock, divan, a few cheap center tables, and a well-worn buffet. There is also an out-of-place rocking chair. Wes, my job to babysit the flashlight. Olivia, should have gotten here earlier. Wes, difference is one more day going to make. Olivia, cold feet. Wes, nothing's wrong with my feet. How about your mind? Wes, it hasn't changed. Olivia sits on the arm of the couch, rubbing her feet. Olivia, sure you didn't see my other flip-flop? Wes, positive. Need to do something about the car. Wes, not talking about the car right now. Olivia, if you had gotten gas when I told you, our shit wouldn't have gotten stolen. Wes, good riddance. Olivia, including our wedding rings? Wes, that a trick question? Olivia, wish the streetcar was running. Wes, we just got here. Now you're talking about leaving? Typical. Olivia, that's not what I meant. Wes, last I checked, we didn't have streetcar money. Till now. He notices something sitting on the windowsill. It's a penny. He picks it up as the light winter shower begins to fall outside. Olivia, put it back. Wes, going to tell me what to do after everything I went through to get us here? Olivia, trust me, it's nothing to brag about. He pockets the penny when she isn't looking. The sound of dripping is heard as it lands inside a metal pail. It remains pervasive and seemingly echoes dreamily in the space. It should intensify throughout the rest of the play. Wes, where's that coming from? Olivia, the dining room. Wes, give me the phone. She hands him the phone and he walks towards a pair of sliding doors and opens them. He removes his mask and gives a quick sweep of the room with the dim light. She says, the roof's always leaked in there. Wes, think we got a mold and mildew problem. That kind of thing gets deep inside the walls. Said this place was only 100 years old. More like 150. Olivia, you usually ask rhetorical questions. That's why I never answer you literally. Overall, what do you think? Wes, it needs more work than I thought. Olivia, story of our lives. And it ain't gonna be cheap, even if I do all of it. Olivia, any good news? Wes, we'll make it work. Olivia, now that my mom's dead, this house is as good as mine. Wes, ours. Don't forget your better half. Wes almost hits his head on a hanging bell. What the hell's this? Olivia, a bell pull. When my family rang it, the servants would show up to serve their meals. Wes, I forgot I'm married to Scarlett O'Hara. Olivia, better be glad you did, because we're never going to go hungry again. Wes, don't make promises you can't keep. Olivia, you got to check out the solarium. Wes, I've seen enough. Olivia, you only saw the upstairs. Wes, you don't know what I saw because you stayed at the motel to bite your nails. Olivia, gotta look at this like another fucking growth opportunity. Wes, don't throw that in my face right now. He sees the couch beckoning him. Dibs. He takes off his clothes, throws a sleeping bag onto the couch. He covers himself with it. Olivia, my old room's probably still got that 3/4 tester bed. Would be pretty noisy if we'd broken in. Wes, I'm staying down here. Why? Wes, you know me. I like being close to exits. A pause as a vine wraps itself around a tree outside. Olivia reluctantly allows herself to be pulled to the couch where she lies next to Wes. He unlatches her fanny pack and throws it to the side. He tries to kiss her. She pulls back. Olivia, the sleeping bag smells like piss and beer. Wes, can't have one without the other. He tries to kiss her again. He presses her body against his. She reciprocates for a moment. Suddenly the house begins to creak and moan. It unnerves Wes for a moment. Olivia notices and laughs. Olivia, baby, it's just the house settling. Relax. Wes, I know what a place sounds like that needs foundation work. He moves in to reestablish the mood, but the chandelier begins to slowly rock back and forth. A southern draft moves throughout the room. The creaking of floorboards, at once pensive, becomes more apparent. Suddenly, the offstage sound of breaking bottles followed by laughter is heard. This does startle Olivia. Olivia, this is a respectable neighborhood. Sounds just like our old neighborhood right now. I like it. A gust of wind whips through the trees. Wes catches a chill. The branches, tendons scratch against the boards on the windows. Olivia becomes clearly frightened. Olivia, I told you I saw someone. Frustrated, Wes throws the sleeping bag off of them and walks to the chimney, feeling inside it. He tries to close the damper. Wes, relax, the chute's open. You get like this when you have to pee. Olivia wriggles her legs in pee anxiety. Any paper towels left? Wes, I used the last one to wipe that roadkill off my high tops. Going to have to drip dry. Olivia quickly grabs the phone and exits into the kitchen with it. Wes walks slowly to the basement door and stares at it for a moment. He is about to touch its doorknob, but thinks better of it. Olivia, damn it, this toilet's been ripped out. Wes, you should have gone outside. Olivia, didn't have to go then. Wes, I'm like a camel, go once every 5 days. Olivia, told you to get that checked. Wes, bathroom's upstairs. Olivia, not going up there without you. Wes goes back to the couch and gets a bright idea before he lies down. Wes, I told you I'm staying here. Use the kitchen sink. Olivia, I can't believe you sometimes. Wes, you've pissed in worse places. Finally, a gush of urine is released as it dissolves into the kitchen sink offstage. Suddenly, from the upstairs area, there's the slow and rich sound of a door creeping open in the recesses of a long hallway. The sound of a large bundle of keys slowly presses through the living room quarters. A long drag of light from a candle appears at the top of the staircase. The weight of each step creates an unsettling chorus. As the figure descends the staircase, its face is eclipsed by the darkness. Suddenly, the light from the candle blows out. Darkness, crickets. Offstage, the sound of a humid winter breeze causes the leaves to blow across the wraparound porch. A match lights another candle that rests in a candelabrum. The lights are up somewhat. Wes sits up and sees Rosette, who speaks with the Creole brogue. She doesn't notice him. The dripping from the dining room ceiling remains pervasive and seemingly echoes dreamily in the space. Wes manages to overtake Rosette and throws her on the couch. Wes, don't you fucking move. Baby, bring me that phone. We got a burglar. Olivia, should I call the... Olivia rushes in from the kitchen with a knife that glistens in the moonlight. She rests it at her side. Olivia, Rosette? Rosette, Madam Olivia. Wes, Madam Olivia, it's a formality. Who are you, Wes? Who are you, the help? Rosette, I used to be, but now this place look after its own self. Wes, anyone else here with you? Rosette, Madam Olivia, no, there ain't been a staff here in years. How did you all get in here? Wes, front door. Rosette, your mom had the locks changed when she threw you out. Olivia, Wes, managed. Rosette, as in north, south, east, and Wes. Wes, short for Wesley. Rosette, last time I run up on you in the front of town, you were with some old man that didn't look nothing like he do. Olivia, we weren't expecting to see you here. Rosette, when the police couldn't find Monsieur Preston, I had to stay till he returned safe and sound. Wes, we couldn't turn on the TV or radio without hearing about Liv's brother and mother. Rosette, all this time you knew and never came till now. Olivia, work wouldn't give me time off. Rosette, what kind of job put work before family? Olivia, minimum wage. Rosette, I had to bury your mother by myself. Olivia, I'm sure you did a better job than I would have. Besides, I wanted to come, but on my own terms. Rosette, speak straight. Olivia, the last thing I wanted to do was to come back here and upstage Preston's disappearance. Disappearance. What happened to your brother wasn't a magic trick. Olivia, Mama's will set this house and whatever's left in it goes to me next. Rosette, if your brother be dead. Olivia, Preston was sickly and always seemed one step closer to death than the rest of us. I figure, Rosette, this should be interesting.
Thank you.
So one of the things about specifically like reading this play, but also just thinking about your own work is really thinking about the stories that you're compelled to tell and the specificity of that storytelling. Last week I had met with someone, an executive from Amazon, and this was one of the things that we specifically talked about, was specificity in terms of storytelling and also the types of stories that they're looking to tell now with their own shows that they're putting on air. She was saying one of the things that really bothers her is reading samples by writers where it doesn't seem specific, it's kind of generic, and really wanting to, you know, find ways to have writers tell stories that they're really compelled by, but also that are really specific to who they are and their experiences. When we look at writers like August Wilson, except for one play, all of his plays, except for Ma Rainey, all of his other plays took place in the Hill District of Pittsburgh, which is very different than any other area in Pittsburgh. The stories that I write about are usually specific to the Black female experience. And one of the last plays I wrote actually dealt with, it took place in post-Watts Uprising Los Angeles. And it's because, not necessarily that I was born during the Watts Uprising, but I was around during the Rodney King Uprising. And so for me, being able to track what happened in my city and the promises that were made between the Watts Uprising and those that were unfulfilled once Rodney King happened were very important for me to document in my own work. And there's a specificity to my city that is completely different than New York or New Jersey or anywhere else. And I think however you as writers choose to do that, either in your poetry or your fiction plays or in your burgeoning TV writing, I think is super important to really drill down into some of those moments. And I think in particular, as we look at other writers, like always evaluating what are those things that you really love about, you know, the writers that you're very much interested in. I would be curious if some of you could use the chat, like really thinking about and maybe throwing in some of the names of people whose writing that you really love or that really you're compelled by.
Oh, this is great.
I remember reading Edwige Dandekot, her first collection of stories, Crick Crack, it just really opened my eyes to a different culture, that the Haitian culture that I didn't know anything about. And just learning about her as a short story writer and her own stories was really compelling. You guys are throwing in here a lot of my favorite artists and writers. Miranda July, I love. Tara Westover, I don't know, and I should know, that should go on my list. Sarah Rule, Lin-Manuel, there's so many great artists in here. Toni Morrison, obviously. Donna Tartt, Steinbeck. I remember spending, I think, most of my junior high years reading all of Steinbeck and Hemingway. Phoebe Waller-Bridge, absolutely. Haruki Murakami. Yes, Edwige. Michaela Cole is someone else that I really love, with Chewing Gum and I May Destroy You. James Baldwin, obviously, as well. These are all amazing writers, and really all of these artists and writers go to the heart of what I'm talking about right now in terms of specificity of their world building. And it really goes to kind of all of these works go to the title of this workshop. I was telling Erica and Andrea, one of the things, I started out as a journalist, actually, and that's why I went to USC for their journalism school originally, and I wanted to be an investigative reporter, after one semester, I just hated it and switched over to creative writing, and where I've read, had a chance to read a lot of the fiction writers listed here. And one of the ways that I describe the work, though, of a writer, I feel like, is that we're very much anthropologists. We really dig into our characters, their environments, and who they are. And I think for me, when I think about the topic of this seminar, I also like to think about how place has informed, if we think about who we are, how we grew up has informed who we are as we're sitting here today on this call. And so we can't do any less on behalf of our characters and our world building when we're creating our own stories. We really can use place as an opportunity to really help formulate who our characters are, and in particular, how to create world building for these characters, especially when you're talking about, you know, writers, like, it's easier to do it with genre a bit, but when you're talking about J.K. Rowling and Stephen King, for example, I read The Institute was the last book I read by Stephen King. And one of the things about that book that I knew, part of it takes place in Falcon Heights, which is a very specific town in St. Paul, Minnesota. And I only know that town because my husband lived near there. And it was also where Philando Castile was killed. So when Stephen King sets part of his book in Falcon Heights, as opposed to just saying it's in St. Paul, or just saying that it's in Minneapolis, in the Twin Cities, it takes on a different levity than being vague. And so when we're thinking about our own stories, and as we're looking at doing some of these exercises, really thinking about how you can build out environment as almost another character in a way. Like really, I think what helped me with fiction writing is you really, in prose, have to build out all the things through the senses. What does it sound like outside? What does something taste like when it hits your mouth? Like all of those things. I think dashes of that can really be used to your advantage as well in plays and also in your own teleplays. I think to use like some, be able to use some explosive language to really set yourself apart from, you know, some of the other writers that are out there right now who aren't doing that kind of work. And those writers, and obviously Octavia Butler, all the writers that really, that we keep coming back to. And if you look in this chat, a lot of them, they do that kind of work. And if they've done that kind of work, then I've always seen it as my job to do the same. I don't want to do anything less. Because also, it's very noisy out there, and it's really hard to keep the attention of people when there's so many different things going on. There's so many different books we can be reading, especially most of us are in quarantine now. There's so many different shows we could be watching. And so we really want to make the best effort to find ways to really captivate the people. Oh, Tracy Scott Wilson, she's my best friend. That just like hit me in a place right now. That's amazing. Yes, Tracy's fantastic. And make I'll just plug her movie for her. She wrote the Aretha movie that's coming out. So yes, stay tuned for that. But we really want to make sure, like in all, with all of these artists, that we find ways to do that. So this first one, everyone can read it, but it's writing a two-person scene about an argument that seems to be about one thing, but is actually about another. And this all goes to the heart of subtext. That's probably the best way to describe this scene. But as you're writing it, really think about like where your characters are at when the scene starts. And also, this is a way to really think about conflict as well. The best way to do any writing exercise, and particularly on a larger scale when you're creating a script, is really getting us in the middle of the scene. Don't just start at the beginning. So when I say in the middle of the scene, it's we're gonna have to catch up with you as the audience about what's happening. Like we're already in the middle of it.
So I think we can start now, and I'll be excited to read this from you all. Run to, we're gonna run to, all on that day, will I run to the rock, please hide me and run to the rock, please hide me and run to the rock. Thank you. Thank you so much, Andrew.
So this next one is to write a two-person scene that starts with the life-changing event. So if you think about, I don't know, some of your favorite TV shows, you think about 6 Feet Under, how that pilot starts when she's on the phone with her husband. You think about, Four Weddings and a Funeral, how that movie starts is basically in the title. Anything that you love in terms of storytelling, writing that really starts with a bang, that can be an inciting incident for a story.
For you I was a flame. Love is a losing game. Five life story fire as you can. Love is a losing game. One I wish I never played. Oh, what a mess we made. And now the final frame. Love is a losing game, played out by the band. Love is a losing hand. More than I could stand. Love is a losing hand. Self-profound. Till the chips were down. Though you're a gambling man, love is a losing hand. Though I battle blind, love faith resigned. Memories mar my mind. Love is a faith resigned. Over futile final frame. Love is a losing game. Is that right?
But I want you guys to think about, and also as we continue with this last exercise, really think about how place can inform who your characters are. Think about where the scene is taking place. And just kind of think about how that can help to really build your character and also your situation, to really help dramatize. So you're not having to do so much building, but some of the world building can help with the character building as well. Right, a two-person scene, opening scene about an average day turned upside down by an unexpected visitor.
Let's do a flash write for this. So let's say we're writing for about 5 minutes. So we'll pump that out and I'll play the music, and then we'll come back around and leave more opportunities for sharing.
Okay. Thank you.
These are great. I love reading work like this. So these are just a few of the books that I have found as a great resource for writing.
The first one is great for screenwriting. I think it's an invaluable resource, and it really helps with story structure in general, particularly for TV and feature writing. When you get into TV writing, especially if you're a playwright, I'm more of a character person, but a lot of times there's a lot of what they call math involved, and math is all structure and plot. And so if you're not as strong as that at that, then a book like John York's book can be very helpful to you with that. The Playwright's Process by Buzz McLaughlin is a real nuts and bolts book. I bought it when I was in grad school, so it's been around for a while, but it's just really simple in terms of just getting you to be able to figure out storytelling with plays. And it's something that I always come back to even when I'm teaching playwriting. There's great exercises in there. He has a great worksheet on character bios to help you build out your characters and their backstories. And also helps you figure out what the dramatic action is of your play, like being able to, ask those critical questions, like, you know, the story of Hamlet is basically to avenge his father's death. And so how do you boil down your own stories in a succinct way like that? And then the last one, since I heard you guys are working on pilots, is Story Maps, TV Drama, the Structure of the 1 Hour Pilot, I think is an invaluable tool in terms of really boiling down how to build your own pilot. And it provides worksheets, and it provides most recent examples of shows that are on air or have been on air. And those include, I think, Breaking Bad, Mad Men, The Walking Dead, and Scandal are some of the examples that are used in that book. And it's a great resource, and I use it as well to help kind of figure stuff out.
Ashley is asking, when you have heavy plot, or in my case, historical events I have to adhere to in my story, how do you get into the process of focusing on character?
Wow, that's a really great question.
You're welcome. Thank you, Ashley. I do actually write a lot about history, but I don't leave myself tied to historical events. It doesn't mean I make up the history, but also because I'm writing, and can I just ask, what medium are you writing in? Is it a book? Is it nonfiction? Is it fiction? Is it playwriting? Oh, screenwriting feature. Well, that even better. So if doing a feature or a play, unless you're doing a documentary, you don't have to adhere so closely to historical events. Historical events never overtake my characters and the development of the story that I want to tell. If we were to do a story of this workshop right now, you don't want to adhere to the exact history of what this workshop just was, because it would be super boring. You know, you have to create conflict, you have to create characters, and that has to be within a historical context, but you don't have it be like have that as a lodestone around your neck to tell your story. If anything, I use historical events as a jumping off point to be able to really tell the story that I want to tell, and to tell it in a contemporary context in a way, if that makes sense. Is that helpful, Ashley?
Yeah, so much. Thank you so much, Christina.
Oh, you're so welcome.
Yay.
On that note, can we all unmute ourselves and give Christina a huge round of applause and thank you.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you.
Oh, you're so welcome.